Alliance. Supporting all 32 counties through the Alliance Leagues.
Hello and welcome to the Throw-In with me, Michael Verney, and in association with Alliance. Will is away this week, so it's just myself in the hot seat, but I'm joined by two journalists known for not being short of a word or two, Roy Curtis and John Brennan of the Sunday World. We'll be discussing hurling with Brennan Cummins and camogie with Ursula Jacob later in the show, but let's start with the football, and I'm joined on the line by Tomás Ó'Se. I suppose, Roy, one of the games of the weekend, definitely, in Croke Park on Saturday evening. Dublin coming from behind yet again. It's a phenomenal resilience that they have and the ability to come from behind when there's a lot of obstacles in their way. Is it a case of them having that resilience, or is it a case of Donegal folding and other teams folding? What do you think yourself?
I think it may be a little bit of both. There's no doubt that within their DNA now, it's entrenched, that champion mentality. They just never feel they're going to lose a game. And I think it's a great credit to, one, the number of leaders they have on the pitch, and two, their enduring hunger. I think we've seen in all sports, whether it's the Irish rugby team, whether it's Manchester City, how hard it is to keep going when you've achieved success. But as a team, they are just consumed with being the best that they can. Now, I know there was some talk afterwards about Dublin cynically finishing the game, and I thought that entirely missed the point, because the most violent and most reckless challenge in the game was perpetrated by Michael Murphy early on, and he should have been off the pitch, not in a position to be being fouled by Johnny Small later on. But I think there's no doubt that psychologically, Dublin also are getting into other teams' heads as well. I mean, the comeback against Monaghan last week was ridiculous, but it just shows that they keep going. And when great teams build that aura around them, it is definitely worth 3 or 4 points a game to them in a tight match.
What do you make of that, John? It's a phenomenal thing that they're able to keep doing.
Yeah, having changed the manager, you would think, will there be a drop-off? Will the manager change things around? If I was the other counties, the really thing I'd be really worried about is, here we are with Dublin, top of the league, joint top of the league after four rounds. They've still to play the division's whipping boys, Meath, which is surely another 2 points. Desi Farrell has come in and he's used 27 players in the four games. He hasn't used either one place Dublin do have an issue going forward is at midfield. And neither Darren Gavin nor Padraig Joyce have been seen yet. But above all, neither have fellas with surnames like Cluxton, Cooper, McCaffrey, McCauley, O'Callaghan, Connolly. And they're leading the league.
Yeah, the three nominations for Footballer of the Year last year, I haven't seen a minute of game time so far. And James McCarthy, perhaps the most influential footballer, outfield footballer of the last decade, didn't play on Saturday. But they just keep rolling on. And you've seen Sean Bugler has been the guy who's come in and really staked a claim. And if you talk to people in Oliver Plunkett's, talk to the Brogans, how highly they rate that guy. Colin Basquiel, who was the star of the club championship, came off the bench and made a significant impact. They're just, the depth is rolling on through, and those guys, Desi knows intimately, having worked with them at underage level.
Interestingly, that Dublin under 21 team of 2017 is becoming a mine of gold. They've already got O'Callaghan, Howard and Merchant. Gavin was on it, Darren Gavin. And they've got, now this other guy, Bugler was part of it. I think Baskill wasn't, but there's another guy whose name escapes me. There's guys still coming through from it, even though they're now 23 years of age. It's become a rich mine of gold, a seam of gold that Dublin are mining and turning into serious senior players. And we wonder about other counties. Can they do that kind of thing? You know, we're looking at Kildare yesterday getting beaten by Roscommon at home. Now, I know it's 2 years later in that Kildare were under 20 champions in 2018. But where are the guys from that team? Where are the guys from that team lifting up Kildare? Dublin just seem to be plucking guys out of nowhere. And of course, we have the guy coming who's still under 20, Kieran Archer. He's still playing for the under 20 team. And that was a terrible, I don't know what happened. Did that guy Shane Walsh get injured the other day?
He
was pulled out of the team at the last minute. Now, if it was an injury, fine. But I know a lot of Meath people had a lot of time for that team. They thought they were very good. They were the Leinster under 17 champions 3 years ago, so they should have been good. They should have been seriously competitive. They should not have been getting hockeyed by Dublin.
Yeah, it's a remarkable conveyor belt that they're bringing through. Just bring in Tomás Ó'Se there. Tomás, Joe Brolly said in Sunday's paper that he reckons Dublin could be managed by Jim Gavin's baseball cap. What are your own thoughts on that?
I reckon Brolly could be the water boy with him, maybe.
they're banned now, Tomás.
When you see, What?
They're banned now, these water boys. You can't be running in anymore.
Banned after Peter Crowley.
Yeah.
I tell you, no, I do think, look, the players that come through, and you've the Aaron Burns and the Baskells and the Conor McHughes and the Bugler, like, I think Davy Byrne at fullback is playing, is having a really good league as well, a very good league. Even that night on Clifford, even though Clifford was very, very good, he started, there was going to be a great battle there. I think it's so, the whole culture in Dublin at the moment, they're winning, they're on the crest of a wave, they're dominant, they're everything. But it's easier for these lads to come in and step up, and people say they're still making a huge impact. Bugler last week was outstanding when he came in. But it is easier for them. Like, in other counties, these successful under 21 teams, you're asking them to actually carry the whole team. Whereas you're not asking these young fellas in Dublin to carry the whole team. And the expectation isn't on them. That doesn't mean that they're not actually carrying the team in some way, because they are. But that expectation isn't there. And they're just coming into a setup that's absolutely seamless. Like Desi Farrell, since he's come in, there's no difference. It might as well be Jim Gavin on the sideline. There is no difference. They're coming, like, in both games, Monaghan game, they should have lost it, but they never give up. There's this ability in that Dublin team to hit you, and to hit you hard. And the amount, was it 5 turnovers and 5 scores? Fenton, who wasn't having... Langan was actually doing okay on him. You know, teams are actually trying to man-mark Fenton. He's so good. Still came in, kicked his 2 scores. Brian Howard was dominant. Like, McCarthy up until now. I know he didn't play the last night. But Kilkenny, like, they're still there. They're, like, it's phenomenal what they're doing. And it's actually scary for the rest of the country, to be fair. Because when they have... When you name the players, the Baskells and the other lads that are coming through from an underage... That pool is going to be there constantly.
While they're unbeaten, Tomás, though, have you seen any areas of vulnerability? I know they're coming from behind in most games and getting a result at the end, but are there any areas that you've seen maybe that Desi Farrell would have a few questions that you might need to answer?
No, I think as the season progresses, Desi Farrell will put his own stamp on it in certain ways, in terms of players he might introduce or roles he will give. As the lads have said, he's tried so many players, it's hard to get a pattern of what they actually want to do, or if he has a role for Bugler, what his specific role is. So you won't see Dublin cranking up the engines until midsummer, where they'll get a kind of, you'll see after a while who the players that will be coming in. Has he any idea for fullback? Will Davy Byrne be there come summertime? Like, what they're doing at the moment, it just goes to show the strength and depth that they have. I think trying to pick out weaknesses in Dublin right now, I mean, the last 3 league games last year, and you were saying, geez, this is different to years before. They haven't got to a final. They haven't got to a league final. What's different? Is there weaknesses here? And we're all trying to find weaknesses in Dublin. But, like, Monaghan couldn't get over the line with them. Donegal couldn't get over the line with them. They just... It's something I admire mostly about Dublin is something you can't really... There's a belief there that they'll keep plugging away. They'll keep going at you. That, like, you can't turn on the switch for that tackling. That tackling brought them into the game last year. And don't anybody tell me that any team in the country can't do that. They can. But it's just the way Dublin go about it. It's phenomenal. And look, finding weaknesses, Michael, is pointless at this stage. There is no weaknesses. And as the other players come back and you have... it's actually scary for the rest of the country. Like, we're here, we're looking at the rest of the teams in the country trying to say, right, who's coming? Are Kerry coming? And from what I saw in Killarney yesterday, you know, there's a lot of work still to be done there. You know, I don't think they're on the level that the Dubs are at. They'll always lift it for Dublin, but it's the matches. Like, it's like United going away to whoever they're going away to, Crystal Palace. They eke out the win. That attitude, that it doesn't change, it's just constant with them, like, and it's great to watch. Like,
just maybe the previous Man United teams, I don't know about the current ones. But Roy, on the flip side of then Donegal, Oisín McConville brought up kind of an interesting stat last night, and I suppose Declan Bonner cut a really dejected figure after the game. They've only won 1 of their last 14 games against basically the top 6 within Division 1, and that was another chance for them to get a victory over Dublin. Like, it is disappointing. It's not a collapse or anything like that, but is it a mental block when they're getting towards those latter stages, particularly against the big teams?
Well, the numbers are clearly there. When it's that sample size of games, there clearly is an issue. And I actually thought Donegal last year could be the team that, even ahead of Kerry, might challenge when you have the base offered by Michael Murphy and Ryan McHugh, that experience. Now, they had an issue with Paddy McBrearty getting injured. Owen Bond Gallagher had issues. But if you look through their team man for man, they have a really, really good nucleus of top quality players. And you'd expect, on the law of averages, that they'd win some of those games. I mean, I think it was particularly disappointing. I was certain they beat Mayo last year when it came to that qualifier. You're looking at a Mayo team that probably wasn't at the level in previous years.
What you were saying earlier, in that game in Castlebar, Donegal were missing five confirmed starters because of injuries or absences. Neil McGee, Owen Bond, McBrearty, McGee at midfield, and Oran McNeilish couldn't play.
That is an issue, John, but I think when it comes down to it, the reliance on Murphy do exceptional things to bail them out is constant. And until Tomás makes a very good point about younger players coming in with Dublin, and they have so many options surrounding them. If you look at Dublin, it's different guys keep rescuing them. Yeah. If you look at Donegal, with the exception of that run McBrearty was on in the early stages of the league last year, for 7-8 years, Donegal have relied on Murphy to be exceptional. And if Murphy falls to 7 out of 10, perfectly adequate for any other team, Donegal have hit that glass ceiling.
Whereas if the Dubs, if someone falls, someone else will stand up.
That's,
it's like the Great Kilkenny hurling team, isn't it?
Yeah. If you look at the Dublin team over the last 5 years and the number of different players who could have been nominated for Footballer of the Year over those 5 years of dominance, there's probably a dozen players.
Yeah, it's phenomenal, yeah. Judge John, one of the main points of the matches was near the end, and particularly the, in inverted commas, cynicism at the end. Just your own thoughts on it.
I wasn't at the game, so I didn't see it in the flesh, but it looked bad on television in the sense of, Dublin were to have a bit of history at the game against Mayo a few years ago, but the teams do it. It's don't react to it. That's the thing. It's like, I know it's easy to say don't react to it, but there was obviously a bit of history between those two going through the game, because there was the Murphy challenge in the first half, which should have been dealt with in a different way. But anyway, all good teams have a little touch of the edge. They all live on the edge. It's never tipping over on the edge is the trick. And Dublin try not to tip over on the edge too often. They tend to get players sent off on two yellows, which is what happened again last night. There has been the odd one that has gone on straight reds. Oisín McConville was talking last night about basketball, the way basketball punishes cynical fouling. That would stop the game, make a thing. No, there were black card offences. This thing of the whole black card thing. The black card is in for five certain defined fouls. And they're happening on the pitch, and the referees are giving yellows or waving play on. Like, I think they've got to bring in the black card and make it, in the sense of making it work. When a fella pulls down a fella, show the black card. Don't pretend that he sort of only grabbed a bit of him or whatever. If you pull someone to the ground, that's what it was brought in for, to stop cynical play. Do it.
Imagine to say some of you football boys want a black card brought into hurling and you don't even know how to deal with it in your own game.
Well, but, you'd have to bring in hurling, you'd have to go back to the punishment in the original football punishment of take the man off and put a man on. 10 minutes with 14 men in hurling would be a huge penalty for what you do. I think in hurling you'd have to go back to the original football penalty. In football, this 10 minutes seems to be working better because teams are suddenly realising, right, we've 10 minutes with an extra man, let's go at it and let's maybe attack and whatever. So it does seem to be working a bit, the new punishment. But if it was coming into hurling, you'd have to go back to the old punishment.
I think we do need to reiterate again, the worst challenge of the game, by far, was Michael Murphy's high, aggressive, reckless forearm stroke elbow moving at high speed challenge on Davy Byrne. That is a red card. Michael Murphy was definitely taken down at the end of the game. Michael Murphy should not have been on the pitch at that stage. He should have been gone after. That was very early in the game, and he became the game's most influential player. He created the Donegal goal. He scored some wonderful points, both from play and from distance and free. But he should have been off the pitch.
It's like the time Ronald Koeman scored the free kick against England, isn't it? He shouldn't have been on the pitch at all. Yeah, go on, Tomás.
Can I just have a speak on that stuff, lads? I think it is, like, the black card stuff, I think it will kind of flush out. I think teams and players have to have a look at themselves in terms of teams are being punished. Like, Kerry notched up 1-6 to Meath's 1 point. yesterday in Clarny because of the black guards. And at the end of the day, when you look at Meath and they're just shy of getting over the line, it's having a huge difference in that way. But in terms of cynicism in the game, it's there in buckets. And don't anybody, like last night it was highlighted and people were laughing. It was the Northern lads that were highlighting it. Like, it's been there for so long now, and every single team can't shy away from it in terms of saying they don't do it. Every team does it. Every team. Like, I know Murphy should have gone for that red. Yes. John Small should have gone the first half for a black card because he pulled Murphy down. Diarmuid O'Connor gave two tackles last night. I watched the game when I came home, and both of them would have been black card if it was in Killarney. Kerry were at it. Tony Brosnan and Micheál Burns. I was watching games all day yesterday. I was watching Peter Hart was taken out of it by Adrian Varley, completely off the ball. It's going on all over the place. And I suppose you have to kind of look at the top players are being targeted and whatnot, like. But if they're getting away with it, they'll get away with it, like. And do you have to go to a stage where you revisit this stuff on TV? I wouldn't like to go down that way. But I think it's incumbent on the players and the actual managers, because this will hurt them in big games. It will be the difference at the end of the day. But it's more of an issue. I think refs and rule, like, I've seen this firsthand. There's rule writers and there's refs. Yeah. I don't think there's no way place where players, refs, and the rule writers are sitting in one room. It's different, like. The refs have an awful, awful job. They are trying to apply stuff that's being written down for them. They are not part of, and they probably have one person in there or something, but they don't have the voice that they should have in terms of applying rules inside in the game, and need to do players. Like, our rules, even the way we trial them, the way we don't trial them, the way we don't see the black spots that are there, the things, the time issue and the black card. Like, it's actually infuriating for players, for referees, for managers, for spectators. Like, and then they bring in, like, I watched the games yesterday, and I keep harping on about it. The way the game has been played, I thoroughly enjoyed whatever football I watched yesterday. And again, the mark wasn't huge in any game, but why are we bringing it in, like?
Yeah.
Why are we actually bringing in stuff like that? Why can't we actually focus our the minds we have and bring players and refs and rule writers to the table and say, right, we have an issue with cynicism here, like, we have to. I do think, and it's only, I think the black card will have an effect, and it will have the proper effect, because teams are losing matches specifically because of black cards. And they'll have to kind of get that across to their players, lads. We're going to lose a big game here if he start doing this, or if we lose players here. And there's stuff going on about it. But John Small could have gone the last day. Murphy should have gone the last day. Every single game I watched, four games yesterday, lads, they could have picked two or three that should have gone in every game that didn't go.
I think,
and that's the reality of it.
I think the most refreshing thing I heard in GA circles in the last 2 months was an interview with Padraig Joyce. It was just before Christmas, and he talked about how he was going to try and restore Galway to old world values, to play the game in a certain fashion. I watched the first half yesterday, just before the rugby started, actually, and I was just mesmerised by how Galway played. It shows that this can be a wonderful game. I mean, they have had people like Shane Walsh not given the freedom to express himself. It's like having a nuclear weapon and decommissioning it. I mean, yesterday they had seven players scoring from play within no time. They had Ronan Steed in midfield kicking from distance. It was direct foot passing. And it shows that ultimately, with all the talk about cynicism and rights and wrongs with black cards, it's a mentality within teams, as Tomás says. It is deeply ingrained culture of cynicism. But the football is there if teams are willing to play. And the officiating, that stretches beyond officiating, because for one referee now to be tasked with all the things he's tasked. I mean, that programme last night made the comparison with basketball. NBA basketball in an area one-sixth the size of a GA pitch has three referees. It is impossible for one guy. And as more and more experimental stroke new rules are introduced, to be a referee is the most thankless task of all.
Yeah, it's a horrible job.
Two refs, Roy, would possibly help out there where one ref is really scanning the other fella is keeping an eye on actual
absolutely
play, like.
In the immortal words of Jack Bootman, the former GA president, two refs, we can only find one good one.
We've kind of segued nicely into Galway, John.
Galway, I'm just going to make the point. Galway and Dublin are the joint top of the table. They both still have to play the whipping boys of the division, unfortunately, Meath. The odds are by the time they get to Salt Hill in the last round of fixtures where they play, they could both actually be in the final.
Be like a couple of years
so
ago.
So that could
yeah.
be like the game up in Oma last year. And then they get to play the final in Croker at the end of March. Now, Monaghan, Kerry will have a little say in that. But Dublin and Galway are a point ahead of everybody else at the moment. And as I say, you would both think they'll click the 2 points when they get against Meath. So they're going to take a bit of stopping to get to the final. So we might see Padraig Joyce bringing that Galway team. Galway have been the enigma. People talk about Dublin at underage. Dublin won 3 All-Irelands in, what was it, 3 under-21s, 10, 12 and 14. And they got all these players out of it who have led to the golden era. Galway won the 2 in between. 11 and 13, and I asked a friend of mine who's in Galway football, I said, where are all your good players? You've won 2 under-21 All-Irelands. Boston, he said. So, and he was right. They all emigrated. But
they do look like a team completely liberated by the way Padraig Joyce wants to play the game. Now, I know it's early days, and I know we can draw conclusions. They're the top scorers in Division 1, and they are playing with a fearlessness. I mean, caution has become the byword in GA. Holding on to possession is all important. Not making mistakes. Joyce has made it clear he doesn't mind players making mistakes. He wants players to try to do things that are exceptional. It really is refreshing to watch. I know when summer comes and teams are paying closer attention, perhaps things will change. But if you look at the way that Galway team in 1998 emerged and they played thrilling football, and Joyce is building a team there in his own playing likeness, and I think he actually has the resources, and I think Galway are real dark horses what come summer.
Interestingly too.
Sorry, Michael, I was just going to say, if you look at it there, what's the difference this year in Galway and last year, or the last 4 or 5 years? It's Joyce. It's Joyce. Like the effect that coaching and management and what Joyce, as a legend of Galway himself, can, and don't underestimate that as well, because if you have Padraig Joyce talking in a dressing room, it does make a huge difference. But Kevin Welsh would have had that aura as well. But the style that he actually plays, like, it just goes. And they were playing Tyrone yesterday. Tyrone, everybody's saying, oh, where are the good footballers? It's not where are the good footballers. It's actually what kind of style of footballer they're playing. They're Galway are expressing themselves now, and they're actually playing. But if you gave, I'd put it like this, Joe. If you put that Tyrone squad, right, and you put them down into a coaching, down into a kind of a group of lads like Joyce has there, and John Dively and all these fellas below, and gave them 2 months at them, and then brought out Tyrone again, Tyrone wouldn't play the same way. And look at what Cavan are doing. Look what Banty is doing above at Monaghan. The coaching that is being put down, the platform, the actual structure to their play, it invigorates the team. It allows them to express themselves. But I think that, like, this is 3 months down the road for Joyce in Galway. And I would say, yes, their attacking play is sublime, but there is still issues at the back. And Tyrone weren't able to expose that. And that is something that Joyce will have to look at. It's all brilliant here at the moment, but... And that football can hurt teams. But that's what you have to try to find. A balance between hurting teams and solid at the back.
I suspect too, Tomás, that he has also taken a good look at the draw for the Connacht Championship and spotted that he can get to the final without having to beat Mayo or Roscommon. So you would expect Galway to be in the final. So I'd say he targeted the league. Let's have a go at the league. Let's have a cut off it. Then we can shut down a little bit and we should make the Connacht final. And of course, once you're in the Connacht final, you're one win from the Super 8s. You either win the Connacht final or you you win the last qualifier. So I'd say Padraig would want to get Galway to the league final. He'd want to have a cut off Dublin or Kerry there, or Tyrone, or whoever gets there. You'd imagine at the moment it'll be Dublin or Kerry, maybe Monaghan. They have a couple of tough matches still to go.
And he's getting a kind of a, like, he's putting a stamp on it. Like the team that Ronan Steed is making a name for himself at midfield. Comer is out on the 40. Yeah. Walsh is inside full forward. They're working around him. Brannigan has been outstanding. He kicked 3 against Kerry below in Tralee, and he was outstanding. Kelly and Heaney are inside in the cornerback. He's given them a kind of a settled team. Yes, players will come in and out, but there's a certain way they play. And geez, lads, watching, like, I came from Killarney yesterday and I watched Kerry, and then I watched Galway after, chalk and cheese, the way Kerry were playing, the way Galway were playing. I was disappointed, very disappointed in Kerry yesterday, but the way Galway played, you say, wow, look at the kick passing, like it was going through the lines, and they were still able to win their ball. If they can get solid at the back, if they can get really solid at the back and sort out their kickouts, they will be a serious, serious contender.
Just on Kerry, Tomás, did anything learn from the weekend?
And look, there was a couple of positives there, Michael, in terms of, I thought Gavin White gave his best display in a senior jersey. I thought he was outstanding from start to finish. I think the way he played was absolutely the way you want him to play. He's such a threat going forward, and he showed that yesterday. Enright was solid as well. Mike Michal Burns kicked a couple of scores, but I was disappointed with the way Kerry played. There's issues with the goalie, there's issues with the full-back line, and when I say issues, I don't think we have the players to actually play in that full-back line that you need, because we're putting back Paul Murphy, you're putting back Tom Sullivan, players who are actually naturally very, very good going forward, and ideally that you'd have them further out the field, but you're going to have to put them back because they were your only option in terms of man-marking. But the one thing that I just did not like again yesterday was, this was an ideal game for Kerry, and everybody was saying Meter being the whipping boys or whatever, this was an ideal game for Kerry to kind of put into work or put into motion what they want to achieve, especially in a defensive area. And I thought it was just very bad. Like, there was the directness that the Galways and the Dublins and the Monaghans against Dublin, like, Kerry seemed to be able to do it against Dublin, but then they can't do it against other teams, like, and they need to get, like, I've seen Joyce's team now a couple of times, and by God, they try to play the same way every day. There was a bite missing in Killarney yesterday, and it was a disappointing. They were midfield, or kind of without David Morn, there was an issue. There's an issue with kickouts, and look, it was a flat performance by Kerry. And look, it's early on in the league, and they're probably safe enough. You know, they get one more win, but they go up to Mayo, and I watched Mayo yesterday as well, lads. Mayo were until they got that goal, Monaghan, and Mayo have tried out 8-9 players. Kerry are going with their best team that they can pick. They're actually going with the best team they can pick week in, week out, where Mayo are trying out players left, right and centre. Dublin are trying out players. The only players Kerry are trying out are forced changes. So, like, if Kerry had, for example, Dave Moore would have been playing yesterday. And I think, like, going forward, there's a big issue at the back. And, like, I would agree with some fella I heard during the week. Nobody's there to bash players. But the reality is, if you aren't good enough, you aren't good enough, I suppose. And, like, I don't mean that in a bad way, saying that they're trying their best. They're trying their utmost. I never question their ability to try. But I was disappointed in the way they played yesterday. I was disappointed in the way that the first thing into their head wasn't to look up for the long ball. Wasn't. The only time they kicked the long ball in, Clifford got a goal. They need to be way more direct.
How far away is Peter Crowley? He was a huge loss last year, and he's still missing now. He's their centre back, isn't he?
Yeah, it'll be a while before I would say Peter Crowley is back. And Tadhg Marley came back yesterday, who will be an option as well inside in the full back line. But Peter Crowley is a guy they certainly missed last year. And look, you can say your defence is as good. Like, when Meath ran at Kerry yesterday, they were in all sorts of troubles. Meath created 4 goal-scoring chances. If there was any bit of bite or any bit of backbone to Meath yesterday, they would have rattled Kerry early on. The 2 black cards really, to key players, caused them serious problems. But the issue, and look, it's not alone to Kerry that you run at any team. You run at the Dubs. Be direct with the Dubs, and it'll hurt them. Like, it hurts everybody, but it's just that Kerry seem to that's fine if you're kind of struggling when teams run at you. You need to run at them directly. You need to put long ball in. And I thought Kerry were so sluggish in moving that ball yesterday. It was a poor performance, I thought, from them, even though it just felt like a match that they were always going to win. Crowley will be key to you coming back. You'll have Tom Sullivan, you'll have Paul Murphy, you'll have Marley. You'll have probably, if Gavin White stayed the way he is, that's it as well. But that's who you're going with. Like, there's no unearthing of any serious raw talent. And you watch James Horan above. Everybody's giving out about Mayo, like, and that they could go down. He is using this league for one reason and one reason only, to get new players that he can use. And I think he is unearthing a few of them. So, I'd be positive enough about Mayo, but it'd be some belter next weekend, because both teams need to win. Tomás, and I tell you, Kerry will need to improve big time.
2 really quick ones before I let you go. Your former manager, Jack O'Connor, is under a bit of pressure in Kildare. And secondly, Paul Galvin's Wexford have kind of bounced back fairly well. Just a word on the two of them.
Yeah, it was great to see Galvin. Like, I mean, for Wexford and for the lower team, like, they play so much emphasis on the league. Now, the league has been tough in terms of conditions, and they went down to Waterford last week and was supposed to be, you know, you could barely call it football. But Galvin, and there was ructions down there early on that fellas were. I think Galvin has put his own stamp on this, and I think he's doing very well with them. I think he, from I spoke to him lately, and he has a young bunch of lads that would go through a wall for him. And I think he's, if he can get up from Division 4, I think it would be a great achievement for him. And they have three tough games to finish off. But it's positive down there. And there's a good buzz down there. And a name like Paul Galvin will bring that to a team. But he has to back it up then, you know, because players will lose trust after a while. Jack is having, it's a tough division above there. And Jack is having his problems. I think the big thing with a team like that is you have to give it an identity. Like Joyce is after coming into Galway and he's after giving them a style of play. What do you do if there's a defensive team? They have their plan. What do you do if there's an open team? They have their plan. How do we counterattack? They have their plan. There's a lot of stuff that Kildare still need to go. It seems like they're only very one-dimensional, that kicking in long ball into Daniel Flynn. They were very poor against Armagh. That's another bad one yesterday. Like when they were ran at, oh my God, when Roscommon ran in those two goals, it was very, very kind of Division 3, 4 kind of stuff. He won't be happy with that. But give him time. Like when I was watching it, actually, what popped into my head was Paddy when he went to Westmeath early on. And they were, the funny one about Paddy was that they were actually calling him OB at home, and he didn't know what they were talking about in the league. He'd go into the bar at home, and they were calling him, hey, Paddy, OB. And he was saying, what in the hell is OB? He says, you'll be out before Easter, Paddy, the way you're going in the league. But he turned it around in Championship. They got, whatever way they actually turned it around, they got a spark. I think the football is in Kildare, but there's a fierce challenge for Jack to actually get that settled into them and get them. They're having fierce problems translating it from defence up front. And I don't know, is it a way that they're used to playing away a certain way? But you look again, Joyce is the actual shining example here of what you can do to a team that were of actually robotically playing a certain way. But then you'll have to change them up. The footballers are in Kildare. He's certainly under pressure, and it's actually adding more pressure to Jack, because the longer this goes on, he needs to get a couple of wins. He needs to get a couple of wins before the championship, because before the league started, lads, we were talking as Kildare being probably the challenge to Dublin. And right now, based on what we've seen, they're all over the shop, really. That's the only way you could describe it.
Great stuff, Tomás. Thanks a million for joining us. I suppose, John, one of the standout performances of the weekend was Monaghan's 9-point win over Mayo, pulled away well in the second half. A very accomplished display, and Banty has kind of gone about business quietly, but he's gotten some good results.
Yeah, and a lot of people were saying that Monaghan were going to be a relegation team this year because they've such a small population that you can't keep doing what they're doing, which is for 10 years they've been a Division 1 team, they've won two Ulster titles, they've been a fantastic bunch. They were leading an All-Ireland semi-final with 4 minutes to go 2 years ago. You forget that. They were that close to the All-Ireland final. And yet he seems to have rejuvenated them. He seems to put a bit of life in them. They're still there. They will regard next week's game as a huge game for them if they can go up to Ballyshannon. Yet again, Donegal are not playing their matches in Ballybuffet. I don't know why they keep
it's
doing it.
It's a fortress, Ballybuffet, yeah.
Fortress,
yeah.
Ballybuffet, and they play everywhere else in Donegal. But anyway, they will think if they can win that they can maybe make the league final, or at least put pressure on Dublin and Galway to take that last game seriously.
I think unquestionably, John, Monaghan are the great overachievers in Gaelic football.
For the size of the population,
they'd hate to hear you saying that.
But that seems like it's patronising. It's quite the opposite. It's paying credit to teams with resources that are a fraction of the teams that they are competing against. And yet they not only compete, they go head-to-head, and they're consistently better than teams that are better resourced, that have more big names. Banty has come back and definitely rejuvenated. I mean, Conor McCarthy's performance yesterday was sensational. I looked again this morning at the goal, and you won't see a better goal year. Really, really wonderful.
Really good use of the advantage rule as well.
This is the thing we always talking about, blowing that whistle. Let it go and see what develops. But they are wonderful. And I am not patronising them in any way, but they are overachievers.
Like how many counties have won the All-Ireland in modern times with a population of less than 100,000? Yours is the only one that's done it in the last 50 years. We are way back to Cavan and Roscommon in the 40s and 50s. As I say, Monaghan were that close. They have beaten Dublin a couple of times. Had they won last week, it would have been three in a row. Now, I know it's league games and all like that, but still, they did it. Other counties are struggling to do it. They are a fine bunch. They would probably love to get their hands on the league title, so that's why Ballyshannon next week is huge. If they can win that, they're right in the mix to go to the league final. Lose it, and because of the way the fixtures are working out, they're probably struggling.
Yeah, and Banty's introduced a few fresh faces as well. Michal Bannigan, that won a Sigerson with DCU. McCarthy, and obviously,
he's
as
got
well.
That guy back who missed most of last year, Niall Cairns.
He's brilliant.
He was brilliant. Yeah. He was great in 2018. He's one of the reasons they were so close to the All-Ireland. He missed all of last year, practically all of last year. He's back. He scored a magnificent point yesterday, and he gives them that strength around the middle that they need, that you need against all the good teams.
Just one other quick point, Roy. I think everyone was writing Cavan's epitaph after the first game.
And
they bounced back
so.
With three great wins.
Well, it was really one of the dark stories that they'd lost a huge number of players. They lose their first game, and you're thinking Division 3 is beckoning here. To come back the way they have is a great credit to them. I would have had them, when I was listening to the interviews before the start of the league, I thought this is a county is almost resigned to, we've had a chance over the last couple of years and it's not going to happen. They have seesawed between Division 2 and Division 1 and they're in pole position to go up again.
Just of the other games, I suppose Cork maintained their unbeaten streak, as did Limerick, and one of the other stories of the weekend is Waterford, who I believe trained with 13 players during the week and travelled to Sligo with 19
on the morning of the match.
No, they travelled the day before. Apparently, yeah. There wouldn't have been too many hotel rooms with only 19 players, so they wouldn't have had to pay too much. But a fantastic win. They probably should have beaten Wexford the week before, so it mightn't have been that big of a shock.
Yeah. Fair juice to them. It's fantastic. Looking at the one big game next week I'm really looking forward to is Longford's game with Tipperary. Both of them need to win if they want to keep the promotion hopes. Crucially, of course, for getting into the All-Ireland. Because Cork are playing Derry, you would imagine Cork would win that at home, beat Derry, solidify their own place in Division 2, and then it leaves Longford, Tipperary, Down and Offaly all scrapping around. Longford were only beaten by a last minute goal by Down in Newry. They'll fancy taking on Tipperary at home, and if they do, they have a chance of going up because they have Cork at home in the last game, by which time Cork might be up and not unduly bothered and whatever. So if they, like, I mean, you talk about teams. Again, Longford, smaller than almost any county. If they could get themselves into Division 2 and into the All-Ireland series, it'd be another fantastic story out of the league. But I think what the league has shown us is what a properly organised All-Ireland could look like, as distinct from the Leinster, Munster, Ulster and Connacht championships, which have different number of teams playing at different levels, and they're just not competitive anymore. This is fantastic stuff that's going on. Oh, and I was on this show a couple of weeks ago and I said, come back to me for the last round of fixtures in Division 2. What are they going to be like when two teams are looking at going down? At the moment, you have Kildare, Fermanagh and Clare all struggling. But, like, I mean, Fermanagh could easily win next week. Fermanagh have got a home game against Armagh, who are chalk and cheese. One week they're great, one week they're awful. They needed a last-minute goal to get a point out of Westmeath. Like, and all those counties know we're playing for our future in the All-Ireland. The next two weeks are going to be good.
Every weekend is a good weekend in the football.
Yeah, it seems to be.
In fairness. That's all for the football talk. Now we move on to the Allianz Hurling League chat. Roy, I suppose there's no point in veering away from it. One of the biggest talking points of the weekend was some of the refereeing in two games in particular. In the Cork-Limerick game and the Wexford-Dublin game, combined it was 92 frees blown. Wexford finished with 13. Dublin finished with 13. One of them sent off. What did you make of some of the decisions? Like, is hurling a game that needs that much policing in that respect?
I think be careful what you wish for is the moral. There's been an awful lot of talk about the black card and the requirement to introduce the black card. There is no question that hurling has its cynical side, the same as any sports, and the holier-than-thou stuff doesn't do any favours, I think. But equally, when the game is let flow, we have had so many epics over the last number of years. And if we are deciding now that we're going to be pernickety and officious and rule by the book and not have any leeway for referees, then you're going to get the stop-start game. The Dublin-Wexford game was unwatchable before the finale on Saturday. It was absolutely awful. Why? Because it was being blown constantly. Again, as you say, the Cork-Limerick game, if you look at the scores accrued by Patrick Horan and Aaron Gillan, it was a free-taking shootout. That's not why we go to watch hurling. It's a free-flowing, swashbuckling game at its best. Now, there is no doubt there has been an increase in cynicism, and there is a desire to stop players going through on goal, and that is an issue. But when the technical calls are constant and when you're stopping a game for stuff that really doesn't need to be stopped, we talked earlier in the football about Conor McCarthy's goal being a triumph of the advantage rule. I think you've got to have common sense and practicality. The beauty of hurling is when it flows. When it's clogged, it becomes a war of attrition. You get guys bunched around the game, around the ball, particularly at this time of the year when pitches are not great and when the first touch outside of Croke Park is very, very difficult. You've got to let the game run.
Seemed like particularly Saturday night when a free occurred, it was a whistle straight away. There was no opportunity, there was no four steps, there was no nothing. Like,
it was almost like it was preordained that the moment something happened, bang, we're blowing it up. There were a number of people who I was speaking to after the game who basically went out. They were there for both games, but they went out and had a pint because they couldn't watch what was unfolding anymore. And they came back in to watch the football. They were so disappointing. Now, there was an exciting end that sort of rescued the narrative slightly, but it shouldn't be allowed counter the fact that if you are going to blow every technical foul, if you are going to have the whistle as a first option rather than as a second or third option, the game becomes far less attractive to the naked eye.
Yeah, I was down in Waterford yesterday. James Owens was refereeing, I think, 22 frees. Yeah. I didn't even know he was on the pitch. And yeah, that's genuinely, whereas you compare that, there's more than double in both games. It's like, they're very small things as well. If you want to pull every foul, you can blow every minute of the game if you want to.
Yeah, it was interesting to hear Roy making the difference between the technical and the physical. I would make the difference on the other side. If a player picks the slitter off the ground, that's a tech. You have to give the free. Yeah. It's the challenge. For me, it's the physical challenge. Where do you draw the line of blowing every time somebody hits somebody, or do you just let them play on? There is the chance of using the advantage rule. I don't know what. excuse me. I don't know what these two referees got it wrong, as you say, but James Owens, an experienced referee, he's handled, what, 3-4 All-Ireland finals. He knows what he's doing. As you said, the best thing about a referee is you don't know he's there. This referee in Croker and the one in Cork, you saw Kieran Kingston saying we're supposed to be a soft team and we gave away 20 frees. Mm. Like, what the hell is going on? Where Cork fed up with this soft team rubbish and decided to, as their predecessors would have said 50 years ago, lower the blades. I don't think so. It wasn't that kind of a game either. It wasn't dirty. There weren't fellas taking lumps out of each other. The ref was just blown for physical contact. He has to blow for the technical fouls. Then he was just blown for any sort of physical contact at all. And it was stop, start. And as you say, Pat Horgan got, what, 20 points? Gillan got 18, 17, 18, was it? You know,
yeah.
Obviously then, they were just... And the thing about hurling too is the free takers... Those guys and your TJ Reeds and your Joe Cannings and all the rest are so good that basically they miss one a season from within the 65-metre line. Yeah. That's it. The minute a free is given, it's a score. And players are knowing that and they're kind of working on it as well, that we have TJ Reed, we have Aaron Gillan, he is going to score. If I can get a free, it's a point.
It's a shame we're talking so much about it, because the league has actually thrown up some really, really feel-good storylines that we can look into this summer. You've had the early redemption of Waterford, a team that hadn't won a game for 2 years since the All-Ireland semi-final of 2017, had basically been going on a sharp downward trajectory, have really created a feel-good vibe. You were at that game yesterday. You have Davy Fitz with Wexford. And there really is a feeling building with Wexford, with Davy going back for that last year, a coming together, that they have one last go at this, maybe as a group with Davy. And the way they are digging out victories, I thought the performance in Kilkenny last week was arguably the performance of the league last year, to give up a 7-point lead, go behind and find the wherewithal to come back. They did it again against Dublin. They found a way. It might not be pretty, but they have developed momentum. Clare, there's a resurgence there. You're seeing Shane O'Donnell back to 2013 type form. You're seeing what Tony Kelly and his capacity to take over a game. And where we looked last year and we thought Tipperary and Limerick might be moving ahead of everybody else now, we might be looking at a two-horse race going forward, suddenly these stories are unspooling. Now, I know there are caveats. Kilkenny haven't had their best players out. Tipperary are building for the league. And Limerick have looked awesome. Limerick really 2019 turned into such an anticlimactic year when everything was going well. Then they had issues off the pitch, but they have strength and depth, as you saw with the way they finished that game yesterday, and they look like the team to beat. I think there are an abundance of storylines as we're looking into hurling summer.
But even throughout the league, and even pulling a result out yesterday, it was a big win yesterday. Again, they seem to be able to find a way.
Yeah, and that's a skill of champions, which at one point last year they held all the three trophies. They had the All-Ireland, the Munster and the league. They had everything sorted. So, you know, they're a good side. They'll take beating. But yet again, this Munster Championship, again, this format, remember, I keep saying it, as long as they stick with this format, two very good hurling teams are going to be finished on about the 10th of June.
Yeah.
In Munster, and one good hurling team in Leinster, with due respect to Laois or whoever, are filling out the Leinster Championship. It was a bad result on Saturday night for Dublin, because looking at the way the fixtures work out, you'd think Wexford and Kilkenny are going to win their last games, and even if Dublin beat Clare, Clare are qualified for the knockout phase, Dublin probably won't qualify. So that was a bad defeat. They controlled most of the match. They had a good 10-minute spell when they had an extra man after the first sending off. And they will be very disappointed not to have won the game. Roy is right about Davy giving it one more year. I still, as the Scottish fella said, hey me doots about Wexford. I just don't think they will have it in an All-Ireland semi-final or final. Maybe they'll get there, maybe they won't even get there. We'll see. The one thing to remember again about Kilkenny is they're missing so many of their best players for the whole league so far. I saw TJ Reid at the races in Goran last week. He didn't look unduly troubled, and I suspect he will be back to his best with a lot of his club mates come the summer.
Just on Dublin, I know you're big into the Parnell Park factor. I think they've won 70% of their league games at Parnell Park. It was 30% in Croke Park before last Saturday night.
Yeah.
Another loss, and another loss where they were in a good position and really should have been closing out the game.
And as you look at the table this morning, a dreadful loss, because basically it has scuppered their league. Unless Laois or Carlow can do something to help Dublin against Kilkenny and Wexford next week, they're out of the league. And so they're sitting idle from next week onwards until whenever the Leinster Championship starts in mid-May. So that is a bad blow for their... You know, it's February the 29th or whatever day, March the 1st. To not have a competitive game from March the 1st until about May the 12th or whatever it'll be, that's crazy. I know we club month, but Dublin are going to be idle the whole month of March as well, and that was a bad blow. It would be one thing if they had got hockeyed in that game, if Wexford had been that's your level, now you know where to be for the championship. The problem was they never had the match won, but they were always leading it. They seemed on top. They were picking off their points. Paul Ryan was turning back the clock to 2013. I thought they had it won, and then Wexford took it off them, and it's a huge blow for Dublin hurling on the very day that Kalosh to Owen win the Leinster hurling title, which was a fantastic win for a Dublin school. I know Dublin College has won it a few years ago with a certain Dermot Connolly playing at wing forward. That's how long ago it was. But a Dublin College's team has won it, but now a Dublin school has won it, which is a fantastic achievement. So all this underage stuff is happening in Dublin, and like the football team, the players are coming through. They just cannot seem to get it over the line. And yeah, they probably regret not playing Wexford in Parnell Park yesterday, as the thing. But you put on a double bill, the people come, you fill Croke Park. That's what it's about. Play the games. Yeah, the record in Parnell Park is so much better than it is in Croke Park or in any other stadium. They just seem to love the place, and it seems to intimidate oppositions. But they don't... They don't play there.
Yeah. I'll just bring in Brendan Cummins. We have Brendan on the line. Just on the other one of the other games in Group 1B, Brendan, Clare and Kilkenny. Clare probably looking at this game and looking back at this game and thinking, how did we only get a draw with this game, and how did we nearly lose this game having dominated?
Yeah, Clare were a bit like Man City for all the world, that they own the ball inside in the game, but the whole key is when you get your dominant period, you have to put teams to the sword, and certainly they didn't when they got on top of Kilkenny. But the other side for Brian Lohan, I think, will be taking the positives out of, which every manager will try to do, is they went down into Kilkenny which is not the easiest place in the world to go. And they were obviously extremely competitive and could nearly have won it. So he has a huge amount that he can take positives out of the game. But there's still the old, I won't say failing maybe in Clare, is that when they dominate the ball, they need to put it on the scoreboard. And again, you know, it's something for them to work on. But they have certainly made good strides there, I think, to now. You know, they played really well in patches and, you know, really had Kilkenny under serious bother there for long periods of that game.
Brendan, would it be fair to say probably one of the stamps of Brian Lohan that we've probably seen in this team, that they are going an awful lot more direct already?
Yeah, they are, you know, there's no doubt about that. And I think in fairness to Brian, like, I don't think there's going to be big mad tactics boards, and that mightn't be, I think that's exactly what Clare need. I think they need to roll up the sleeves, get that little bit more direct. If you watch Tipperary, like, of last year, you know, get the ball inside, not aimless, long, lorried into the lads, but they have certainly the skill set to deliver balls 60, 70 yards in front of Shane O'Donnell and the inside forwards, Podge, you know, and get them on the ball in the danger area and let them express themselves from there. Because I know it's a number of years back now that when Shane O'Donnell got the right ball inside, that he caused absolute wrecking Clare and up winning All-Ireland. So, I mean, if they are going to get the last spin out of this group of players, being more direct is going to be the key. But smart, and they have the players to do that. I think if you tell Tony Kelly, Laurie it in, he'll put it into somebody's eye anyway. He's that kind of a player. So, I mean, getting good, effective ball to the inside forward line quickly is going to be the key to success for Clare.
Brendan, we briefly touched on the Limerick-Cork game, but we can't talk about it without talking about Keane Lynch's, I don't know what you'd call it, a little flick through his legs. Have you ever seen, like, it's unbelievable thing, you wouldn't even try it out in the back garden by yourself, let alone try it in the middle of a league game, and he just did it so seamlessly, it was unbelievable.
Well, I think he's thrown the gauntlet down to Austin Gleeson. Remember Austin Gleeson at the Turles end of Turles there in the championship? He slid into the ball and tapped it up into his hand while he was on the slide. These guys, like, I mean, are just absolute geniuses with hurlies. They do things that you're going to win a minute. And actually, in fairness to Derek last night on the league Sunday, he had to slow it down, put a magnifying glass on it so we could all see the brilliance of what Keane Lynch did, you know. And, you know, it is magic. And that's why we all watch the games, is to watch guys flourish. And you chatted about Dublin earlier there. The Limerick players at the moment are on absolute high with confidence. And you can imagine Dublin players, if they can get any bit of confidence. Now, you can't just go into a player and shake them and say, you're confident. But if they can get confidence in their game, you know, they're well capable of playing at a much, much higher level and intensity than they're at the moment and winning games and putting Wexford to the sword. But when you see teams like, we'll say, Tipperary and Flo, Kilkenny, and Limerick now especially, the skill level is just through the roof. And Keane Lynch is one of the greatest ambassadors we have for those kind of quirky X-factor moments.
Doesn't matter, Brendan. You'll never beat John Troy against Brian Corcoran. That's still the best.
Good man. It's nice to have a bit of Offaly influence in here, not just myself.
Yeah, that's important. There we get the bit of Offaly. But I mean, like, no matter how bad a hurling game is, there's always going to be something in it. And the pitch below in Páirc Uí Chaoimh was absolutely immaculate. And the game reflected that in the way players expressed themselves. So, all in, that was a fantastic moment in that game.
Brendan, just a former teammate of yours, obviously, Liam Cattle, doing a very good job with Waterford, by all accounts. Just going back through it last night, his two of his wins in the league so far have been by the minimum, so by a pint. Both in Walsh Park, there was a fair roar went up when they won yesterday. He seems to have turned things around a little. They're a very, very hard working team now. I think that's his main emphasis, is that when the people of Waterford look out, that they're going to have a hard working team there. He has done a nice little job already. I know it's very, very early, but he looks to have kind of awoken them from their slumber a bit.
He has, there's no doubt. And I think if you told War supporters this time last year when they're going to lead, that you'll go well next year without Philip Mahoney and Noel Connors on the panel, they go, wait now a minute, they're our leaders. They're our kind of, you know, they're the spiritual leaters of the group, and they're now not there, and Waterford are driving on. And that's the evolution, I suppose, that was probably needed in the group. And it's gas when you get an outside guy in like Liam, like he's won two All-Ireland under-21s, under-20s, we'll say, back-to-back. And he's got a winning mentality, you know, and Mikey Beavan's with him as well. And I know some of the background team he has around the group. So he's got a good crew in there. And yeah, I mean, for me, his project was really working when they conceded the goals against Cork early in the first round of the league. The kind of oohs and ahs were obviously coming from the stand. If you're Liam going on the sideline, you're going, oh my God, this is the worst thing ever. But the players responded and they said, right, we're different. We're new Waterford. We're not going to take anything lying down. He's going at every game bald-headed like it's the All-Ireland, and rightly so, because he wants to get that magic word confidence into his players. And he has it now, and winning tight games like that, especially against Galway. They do seem to have a bit of a hoodoo sign over Galway anyway over the last number of years. But, like, you know, to beat Galway again, the test, the bar goes up all the time. Now, I think they have Limerick and Tipperary to play next. So, again, he'll find out a little bit more about his players, but there's no doubt the work he's doing during the week is fantastic and the players are responding. And I'm delighted. I walked down around Waterford. There's a good old buzz happening around there. They're cautiously saying maybe there's green shoots here, which is no harm either to be that level of cautious there. But Liam Cahill, they're in good safe hands with him now.
I'm just looking in the group there. This back match between Tip and Galway, Brendan, whenever it's played, it's a couple of weeks away yet. But by the looks of things, it could leave the loser. We were just talking about Dublin hurlers being idle for 2 months. Now, I know this year is all about retaining the All-Ireland for Tipperary, but you don't want to be idle for 2 months either. You don't want to finish your game in early March and then be told your next game is May the 12th or whatever it is.
No, you're dead right there. I think it was all about just trying to get fellas fit after being back from the holidays and the trips and all this kind of stuff. And I think that body of work was probably done for Tipperary in January into the first couple of weeks of February. Now it'll be about getting results. And the weekend now, they put Westmeath away relatively quickly. You know, by the team picked with Ford and Callan and all in, that was a statement of intent. Now it'll be trying to beat Waterford and then beat Galway. So Tip are two games away from All Ireland, a National League quarter final, which is something I think they'll want because it gives you that extra couple of weeks to preparation before you lead into the club month. So Tip, I think we're trying to time their run a lot of ways. So we see the real Tipperary now in the next two games, which is fantastic for Waterford now because Tip will be coming, I think, all guns blazing to try to put one over on Liam Cahill because they need the points to stay in this league for as long as possible for the reason you said earlier.
Just a quick word on Galway, Brendan. Amazingly, in three games, they've used 30 players already and an awful lot of new faces. They were without Joe Canning yesterday. He had a tight calf, Shane O'Neill said, after captain Páraic Mannion limped off after about 18 minutes. What have you made of them so far? He was unequivocal about the fact that it was all about championship yesterday. What have you thought of them so far?
Well, he needs to settle at some stage in the last couple of games of the league of what he thinks his first 15, and it looks like at the moment that they're a long way from finding it. I know from talking to people, hurling people in Galway, they said, oh, there was a great strength and depth up there now, and maybe Maldonado being gone means that it opens the door for other players. Well, I haven't really seen those other players just yet now. So it looks like he might have to go back to the old guard and start to rejuvenate them again. But that'll have to be done, I think, in the next couple of weeks, because if he doesn't qualify for the latter stages of the league, the long gap is going to have a huge effect on Galway. You just cannot recreate in a challenge match the kind of fire that you get in a league game. So he does need to try to get the ducks in a row. Like, if you think about where Tipperary are at, they kind of know they're 15. Kilkenny will know it as well. Waterford, by the time they're finished this, will have confidence and know it. But Galway and Wexford definitely know it. Galway would be seen as one of the major, the top five. And at the moment, they probably don't really know where they're at with their team, the style of play they want to put in place. So they have to create an identity now in the next month, I would say. Otherwise, you can't just turn it on on the 10th of May when the championship starts.
One of the most important games of the weekend, I suppose, maybe might have flown under the radar a bit, was the Laois and Carlow game, played in horrendous conditions in Amore Park on Saturday evening. An important win for Laois, particularly Carlow came back at them and it was level. They got the final point of the game to win 15-14. It's an important win for Eddie Brennan after having such a good... They did well in the league, got to the quarter-final, and did well, obviously, in the championship, getting to the quarter-final as well. Important to kick on and not kind of be in that kind of quagmire of a relegation playoff.
Well, it is, you know, you want to keep the feel-good factor, especially within the players. I mean, supporters will nearly always say, look, sure, the teams are tough and all, but it's very hard to go out training again of a Tuesday night if you've gotten walloped on the Saturday or the Sunday. And you start to say to yourself, my God, maybe I'm not really at this standard, which we saw last year. Leash definitely are, you know. So what they are when the ground is hard and when all the preparation is right, they get a bit of momentum. So that was a huge win for Eddie Brennan the weekend. For Colin Bonner, look, they still have the Joe McDonough later in the year where their games that'll be that where they'll feel they have a great chance of winning. So there's still the excitement to face into that, whereas if Eddie's team keeps getting punnelled in matches, you're going, oh my God, now he's a Leinster championship and we've Galway, Kilkenny and Wexford to play. And based on the way it happened last year with Carlow, the stronger teams now have to really kill the weaker teams in the Leinster Championship, because if it comes down to score difference, you don't want to be like Galway, who, ah, we got a good win against Carlow, that's good, now we'll move on, and then find later in the year, God, we're about 8 points short in the way we beat them. So it's going to be hot and heavy for Leash in the Championship, but if they can get little crumbs of confidence like they got the weekend, it just makes training easier and better for them, and they'll be better prepared now, I think, going into Leinster with hopefully keeping their Division 1 status.
And Dublin will be playing them in Parnell Park. They ain't going to Croker for that one.
Just lastly, Brendan,
no,
as well.
Dead right.
Lastly, Brendan, you're involved with Kerry, obviously, with Fintan O'Connor. Your boys are going fairly well. Looks like you're fairly safe into a final, I think, after last weekend.
Your answers now here, Brendan. Offaly are in this fairly division. Yeah.
Fairly safe from the Offaly fella. I see the propaganda you're flying around the place about poor old Offaly. Look, we're not. We're a million miles away from being safe. If we lose this weekend, Antrim are qualified, and I don't see Antrim playing the full whack against maybe Offaly the following week, knowing that they're in a league final the week after. So it's a big game for both Antrim and Kerry this weekend. Both going going well in the league. There's no good in saying otherwise. Both have good records in it. But it all comes down, really, to be honest, in Tralee next Sunday. So, it's exactly as it was where Kerry and Antrim would want to be in real competitive matches now, with a small bit of confidence going, as the Offaly had a very strong win against Mayo over the weekend. So they're starting to find their mojo as well. So I think that just shows the tiered structure of the league, how good it's been for both Antrim, Kerry and Offaly, and that, you know, they're getting a bit of confidence from it. So we're down the home straight now in the business end of it. So every win now puts you in a league final or unfortunately, teach about the league. That's just the way it is.
Just lastly, Brendan, the weather obviously scuppers Kerry a bit. Like, I know I heard Fintan saying he was kind of worried, I suppose, of that fact, if Antrim were to beat you this weekend and we're in the final, that because the game was delayed, that maybe you could end up coming out in the wrong end despite only losing one game, which would be a bit kind of mad.
No, it should be the same madness for Antrim or Offaly if they happen to lose one game. We all end up the same points and score difference. That's just the way it is, you know. And if like, with the great respect, we played Wicklow last weekend. I was seriously impressed with the job that Scanlon has done above, with Eamon has done above with Wicklow. I mean, like, you know, you don't really know. Like, when you're Tipperary, seen Tipperary hurling all this all your life, and you go up then to play Wicklow, you wonder what's going to happen next. You know, and they were exceptionally good. They were really organised. The play was really good, determined. You know, there was nothing wild or mad about it. They had some fantastic hurlers. So, you know, like, I get to see what's in other counties, and it's been really, really, really impressive, the work's been done up there. So, you know, I mean, the weather and all that, I mean, we still have to beat Antrim this weekend, I think, either way. And that's just the way it is. And I mean, the mindset of every team that plays really is try to win the game, keep everything in your own hands, you know, and try to make sure that, as I said, your destiny is in you. And if we don't qualify for the league final, well, then that's just the way it goes.
You're travelling the country serving your apprenticeship, Brendan. You're a clever man.
Is that what you're calling it? Is it?
Good man. Thanks a million for joining us, Brendan. Appreciate that.
No problem at all.
Thanks a million, good man. That's great, John and Roy. Thanks a million for joining us. Great to have the Sunday World's Finest in on a Monday morning with me here.
On a Monday morning.
So for the final part of this week's show, we're taking a look at all the week's camogie action. I'm delighted to be joined by Wexford camogie legend Ursula Jacob on the line. Ursula, I suppose the standout result of the weekend would be Clare going down to Nolan Park and causing a big shock by defeating last year's All-Ireland finalist by 2 points.
Yeah, I think Kilkenny would have been going in as pretty strong favourites against Clare, especially on their home turf. But credit to Clare, 3 years ago they came to Nolan Park in the Championship and drew with Kilkenny as well. So maybe there's something about Nolan Park that brings out the best in the Clare team. But look, Emer Kelly was excellent throughout. You know, she got 7 points, and I think the crucial thing for Clare was getting that goal. And it probably arrived at the right time midway through the second half. I think from maybe a Kilkenny point of view, they'd be disappointed that, you know, they didn't get a goal themselves. I suppose that's something that's become so accustomed and associated with Kilkenny, is scoring goals. And, you know, Sean O'Kenny in the Clare goal did make a couple of good saves yesterday, and that was crucial for Clare, and they'll be really happy that they conceded no goal. But for Brian Dowland and his team, that they'll be looking to kind of move on to the next game and really try targeting getting a few more goals. But from a Kilkenny point of view, you know, I don't think they'll hit major panic stations just yet. You know, they only had 6 of last year's All-Ireland winning team, or last year's All-Ireland finalists playing yesterday, so they've lots of girls to come back in, you know, Anne Dalton, Katie Power, the Farrells, Grace Walsh. So, you know, I think Brian Dowland is probably experimenting a little bit with some of the younger girls. And a few of them did show up well, you know, like Katie Nolan, Michaela Keneally, Aoife Prendergast, you know. So I think they're trying to build a panel more so than anything, and seeing can they get a bit more strength and depth for this year.
He's a fairly star-studded backroom team around him as well, with Tommy Shefflin and Philly Larkin there as well. So there's probably going to be a small bit of a transition. But just looking at Galway then, Ursula, Galway kind of business as usual really for them, with a fairly comprehensive defeat at Limerick. It was 4-13 to 7 points. They're, Galway are in a, like, they've never been great, shall we say, at defending the All-Irelands that they've won in recent years, but they're in a quite a good position coming in this year.
That's it. You know, they're starting off the year as reigning league and All-Ireland champions. So no doubt the intent is to get back to a league final. And the fact that this year in the league, it's only the top team from either side reaches the final. So they seem to be kind of going all out to win their games and, you know, keep that consistent play that they had last year going for this year. But look, they probably had a sluggish start to the league last week against Dublin, but really, I was very impressed with watching the game yesterday. You know, the four goals that they got in the first half really proved the difference. You know, Niamh Hanafy was crucial to this. She even looked so sharp every time the ball went into her. She either got a score herself or she had a hand in each of the other goals. So that's going to be something that Cathal Murray and his management team are going to be really thrilled with. And, you know, they had such experienced players, you know, around the field. And on top of that, they have the Sarsfields players to come back in, the McGrath sisters who are back in the panel this year. So that's going to really add to the strength and depth of the Galway panel, because, you know, the Galway, as you said, have been considered in the past, maybe they've won a league or a championship and then failed to kind of build on this. So I think Cathal Murray will be very happy with yesterday's result.
Ursula, you mentioned the Sarsfields girls obviously won't be in till after this weekend, probably won't be in for 3 or 4 weeks. Strachneil are going to try and do something fairly remarkable at the weekend, going for 4 All-Ireland club titles in a row, which would be a phenomenal achievement. Just a little word on Strachneil first, and then how do you see the game going?
Well, look, you have to really admire Strachneil and what they've done, you know, to win one All-Ireland. You know, I've been lucky enough to win two club All-Irelands and on two separate occasions. And, you know, it's extremely tough to get through, you know, any of the Ulster, Munster, Leinster championships. So credit to Strachneil, they've really stuck at it. You know, they've been really blessed with having, you know, Tina Hannan join their setup as well, because she's been really, really crucial. Sarsfields are not going to fear playing them either, because, you know, they've met him on two previous occasions, and I think it's really going to go down to the wire. But I think you can't really look past Strachneil either, because they've built such a kind of bond, and they know how to win in Croke Park. You know, they've been there 3 times and they've won 3 times. So they're going to be going to really create history and go for the 4 in a row. But I think it's going to be a really, really, you know, close game. And the McGrath sisters in particular, you know, Siobhan McGrath has been excellent even throughout the Ashburn Cup with UL. So I think, you know, the likes of them are going to be really crucial for Sarsfields in the final.
The curtain raiser, of course, for that game at the weekend is St. Rhinus from Offaly, who I'd be shot if I didn't wish them the best of luck. They're playing Galtier from Waterford. I think it's a repeat of last year's semi-final, which should be an interesting game as well. But just shifting back to the league, Ursula, obviously a lot of new rules been trialled. They're only been trialled in this year's league for the moment, and I believe feedback will be given throughout the league and then at the end of the league to see whether they're maintained throughout the championship. How have you found them in particular? Obviously, one of the major ones would be that you can't drop the hurl anymore. Did they get rid of the hand pass goal as well, I think? And there's a couple of other little bits and pieces.
To me, I think it's a very positive step for camogie in general. You know, I was down at the Cork-Waterford first round game down in Parky Cueve, and the flow to the game was so, so much better. The speed to the game, you know, and obviously it's going to take a bit of an adjustment for players to get used to, you know, not dropping the hurls or, but the, you know, even the kind of contact, you know, camogie has never been a non-contact sport. So the fact that they've, you know, alter the rules slightly, that, you know, there's minimal contact allowed, you know, because I think that's going to add to the game. It's not encouraging dirty play or anything like that. But, you know, all these girls that are playing senior in the county, you know, Camogie, are doing strength and conditioning. They are looking after themselves, you know, even better than ever. So I think it's really encouraging, and it'll be interesting to see what the feedback is after the league, you know, finishes, because I think the more the rules become aligned with the hurling rules, I think it's a positive step for Camogie. And I think all we are asking for is that the game is, you know, girls are allowed to play, it's not being stop-start, and the referees are not, you know, constantly blowing for every tackle that takes place in the game.
Be very strange, Ursula, if the rules weren't maintained for the championship, because then you're basically training, you're playing, obviously playing games and training for certain type of rules, and then if they're not used in championship, then you're kind of going back to the old rules, which was a bit all over the place depending on who, what type of referee you had in the game. So you'd be, I presume most people would be hoping that they're maintained, and I haven't really heard anybody complaining of any of the rules, maybe a couple of little tweaks, but in general they've been received very well.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think you have to, if you're going to allow a trial period with the rules, I think you have to allow it further than just the league. You know, I appreciate that you want to have, you know, feedback after the league, but even if there needs to be some further tweaks to it, I think it should continue going into the championship, because as you said, players and managers are going to get used to what they've been doing during the league. And then if it comes back into the championship that they're all of a sudden going to be allowed hand pass goals and drop the hurdles, you know, it becomes confusing and for spectators and players alike. So I think in order to kind of create a more consistency across the board, and to be fair to referees as well, if it's to and fro in between the new rules and back to the original rules, you know, they're nearly going to become confused on the pitch, because they may allow it, you know, sometimes, and they may not allow it at other times. So I think in order to create that little bit more consistency, I think they should be trialing it for the full year, and see how it goes and implement them then on a full-time basis then, depending on how this year goes.
Ursula, thanks for joining me on the show, and that's it for this week on The Throw-In in association with Allianz. Myself and Will will be back next week, and don't forget to subscribe and listen to the show on Apple Podcasts, Spotify or independent.ie. I'm Michael Verney, and thanks for listening.
Allianz, supporting all 32 counties through the Allianz Leagues.